观众朋友们晚上好，欢迎您收看由凤凰卫视每周台为您带来的天天话题栏目，我是小诗。在美国呢，有超过300万人患有青光眼，但实际呢只有一半的人知道自己患有这种眼疾，因为症状不是特别的明显。而一旦到了被诊断出来的时候呢，其实病情已经发展到比较严重的程度了。那么我们只有正确的认识青光眼这种疾病，才能避免眼睛在不知不觉中就面临失明的风险。今天呢，我们就为您连线眼外科青光眼专科医生 Dr. Billy Pan， 来为大家厘清一些有关青光眼的常见误解。Hello, Dr. Pan, it's great to have you with us today.
Thank you so much for having me. Pleasure to be here.
Absolutely. People know that glaucoma is an eye disease that can cause permanent vision loss or even blindness. But unfortunately, there are so many misconceptions that leave people misinformed. So we have collected some common myths about glaucoma from our audience today. So we would like to have you to separate the fact from fiction for us.
Happily. I think that'll be a very useful endeavor so that we can help to dispel some myths and also to make sure that everyone is on the same page about the truths.
All right, let's get started. Myth number one, glaucoma is only one disease. Are there many types of glaucoma?
The answer is yes. Glaucoma is a very complex disease process, and the ultimate outcome for all of these different types of glaucoma, unfortunately, is a potential loss of vision. However, there are different types of glaucoma. For example, the most common types that people have probably heard of include open-angle glaucoma and closed-angle glaucoma. And then between those two types of glaucoma, there are multiple subtypes of each. So the short answer is yes, there's multiple different types of glaucoma, and the long answer is there's a lot of different ones that we could go into details about.
Yeah, are the symptoms similar among all those different types of glaucoma? Can you just briefly introduce us?
The symptoms of this condition actually, for the most part, almost all patients have no symptoms at all, meaning that it is silent. So this is also known as a silent thief of vision. So the silent nature of it means that patients don't have any discomfort, they have no pain, they have no sensation at all of glaucoma until, unfortunately, it's too late when their vision starts to become affected. And when that happens, then we are already in a late stage of glaucoma. So it's very important to screen patients early on so that we can catch disease as early as possible. There are rare cases in patients where pressures can elevate very quickly in the eye. Mm-hmm. And the pressures are elevating very quickly, then some patients can feel like they have pressure in the eye or sometimes a very bad headache on that side. So that can happen, but thankfully that's not very common.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned like angle closure glaucoma and open angle glaucoma for the biggest type of glaucoma nowadays. My question is, which one is more severe?
That's also a difficult question to answer. Between the two types, open-angle glaucoma and angle closure glaucoma, the latter, the angle closure glaucoma subtype, tends to have, in a small subset of patients, a very rapid onset. So pressures can go from normal to dangerously high within a second. And in those cases, these patients are in a dire situation that requires emergency care. And if not cared for within a short period of time, anything within minutes to hours, patients can lose a substantial amount of vision in that eye. On the other hand, for open-angle glaucoma, the pressures are usually are high, but they usually creep up slowly. They don't have sudden jumps. And in these circumstances, medications and surgeries can often adequately control the pressures.
So the conclusion is we may not be able to diagnose by ourselves which type of glaucoma we have since the vision loss, especially for open angle glaucoma, since the vision loss begins with side vision. So we may not be able to tell it right away because the tell it right away that of our vision is impaired. So the only way to tell is to have a complete eye exam glaucoma testing to be specific.
I agree. The symptoms of glaucoma in its late stages is that central vision, the vision that we focus our vision on, is impaired and affected. And that's when patients start to notice that they have visual loss. However, glaucoma damage usually, almost always, will start earlier on the sides, in the periphery. And in those circumstances, if a patient has peripheral vision loss, they're not going to notice this.
Yes.
Until that peripheral vision loss starts to constrict down and again starts to affect central vision. So absolutely, early detection is imperative for treatment of this disease.
Got it. All right, Miss Number Two, only older people get glaucoma. Yes, that's my thinking too. I assume it's an aging eye disease.
You are mostly correct, and I think to think of glaucoma in this way is going to cover most of the patients that we treat. I will often tell my patients that the risk of this condition starts to increase as the patient's age increases. So into the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the risk of this particular disease does become higher, and the prevalence of this disease becomes higher. However, that is not to say that a patient can't have glaucoma at a very young age.
Like 20, 30?
Well, there are such things as congenital glaucoma. So patients who are born right out of the womb, they will have glaucoma. And oftentimes these are patients who had some kind of malformation of the eye where the fluid can't get out. And then, of course, there's patients who can get it in their childhood, in their teens, in their 20s, in their 30s. And we oftentimes call this juvenile open-angle glaucoma because they're getting it at such a young age.
Yeah.
And glaucoma can also happen after trauma. So if there's direct ocular trauma, patients can sometimes develop glaucoma after these traumatic episodes.
So the conclusion is glaucoma can happen to anyone with any age. It's just older people have higher risk than young people.
Yes, absolutely correct.
Okay, let's go ahead. Miss number three, glaucoma only occurs with elevated pressure. First, what's the normal range of eye pressure?
The normal range of eye pressure that we oftentimes talk about is between about 10 and 20, 21. Now, normal range is not a number not a range of numbers that I like to talk about too often because it does give certain patients a sense of ease if they are within that normal range that we talk about. However, just because you are above the normal range, that does not mean you or any patient will inevitably develop glaucoma. Some just have very, very sturdy eyes that even with high pressures, they never develop disease. And there are also patients who are in the normal range of pressures who do develop disease. So they are in the teens and they will still get glaucoma. And for these patients, unfortunately, sometimes their glaucoma diagnosis is missed because their pressures are never in those 20s, the 30s that sometimes will trigger our alarm bells, but rather they're in the teens, but they're still having progression of disease. And so those are the ones that we have to be extra vigilant about.
Yes. What if the pressure is extreme low or extreme high?
Extremely low pressures don't happen unless a patient has had glaucoma surgery or kind of trauma to the eye. Because the way that the eye is formed, that pressure can't go too low unless there's some kind of external force. On the other end, if the pressure is too high, the higher it is, the higher the risk for glaucoma and the higher the progression, the faster rather, the progression of disease if a patient does have glaucoma. So both of those two states, either too low of a pressure or too high of a pressure, are both bad for a patient.
Mm-hmm. Can we detect it at home? Is there any home device like those for high blood pressure? Like, can we do it at home?
The answer is yes. The way that a patient can check their own pressures at home is through these devices that can be used at home to check your own eye pressure. Mm-hmm. They are a little bit more difficult to use, a little trickier to use than home blood pressure cuffs. And unfortunately, they're also a little bit more expensive, so they're not as easy to get. A home blood pressure cuff, you can go to Amazon, you can go to Walmart, Target, and you can buy something very affordable. Unfortunately, for the home eye pressure monitoring devices, they can be quite a bit more expensive, in the hundreds, if not thousands of dollars, to buy these devices. However, some of them can be rented for a period of time so that you can check pressures at home. And they're a good adjunct for our monitoring and treatment.
Okay. Can you repeat the name again? What's the name of the device so our audience can get it if they need it?
There are a few different devices. I would say the one that is that's probably the most accessible by patients at home is called the iCare. It's spelled I-C-A-R-E, iCare, home, H-O-M-E, iCare home device.
Okay. So based on what you said, ocular hypertension is the leading cause to glaucoma. So my question is, when we have extreme high or low IOP, can we feel it? I think you mentioned that we can. There is basically no very obvious symptom for the very high or low symptom. But is there any tiny little symptom that we need to pay attention to, like closely monitor ourselves?
Well, if a patient has very low pressure, they can develop pain in the eyes.
Okay.
And also develop blurry vision in the eyes. And when the pressure is very high in the eyes, patient can also develop pain and also develop blurry vision. So both of those circumstances can result in patients developing blurred vision and discomfort, although high pressures tend to be much more common than low pressures.
Okay, we just need to remember if there is any change about our eyes, we need to go to see a doctor.
Yes, absolutely. Anytime there's any changes in vision or any discomfort in the eyes, seeing an eye care professional will be a good first step.
All right, let's go ahead. Myth number four, diagnosis equals to blindness. Actually, you know, there are some people do think once they get diagnosed with glaucoma, they think they're going to be blind.
The fortunate thing about glaucoma in current modern medicine is that as long as it's detected early, we can really preserve vision very well, meaning that we have lots of different medical drop options, eye drops. We have different types of lasers, and mm-hmm. we have a lot of different types of surgeries that can be performed in order to try to save the vision that a patient has. But that's the key word here, is to try to save the vision, meaning that whatever vision a patient presents to me with, that's the vision that I am aiming to preserve. I can't get any vision back that has been lost, but if we are catching this early, almost everybody can have their vision preserved for the duration of their life, whether it be 10 years or 100 years, depending on, of course, when the patient's glaucoma is detected. So glaucoma now in current modern medicine is very treatable, and we have lots of different options available.
So it's highly treatable, but it's not curable. There is no cure currently.
That is correct. Currently, there is no cure for the disease. So if a patient has glaucoma, they will have glaucoma forever. That is absolutely true at this time. That is not to say that cures may not occur in the future, and that could potentially be possible. However, at the moment, we can only treat, we can't cure glaucoma.
All right. So can you briefly introduce us what's the latest treatments right now, and what are those treatments aimed at?
The latest treatments currently in glaucoma include different medicines that are coming on the market. There was a period of about 2 to 3 decades where we didn't have any new medications that came onto the glaucoma market. But in the past 3 years, we've had 3 new medications. Mm-hmm. And a lot of research going on in terms of bringing new medication and new topical medical therapy to the treatment for our glaucoma patients. So these medications have been revolutionary in appropriate patients who require these medicines. On the other spectrum are surgical advancements. So we have a lot of surgeries available now that fill in a gap that we didn't have available before. Before we had either medicines, or we jump into big surgeries that are aggressive surgeries that lower the pressure a lot, but also are associated with more complications. And more recently, in the past 5 to 10 years, we've had a lot of advancements in what we call MIGS, or minimally invasive glaucoma surgeries, that fill in the gap and are good for patients who have mild, moderate glaucoma, who need some pressure lowering, but not necessarily large amounts of pressure lowering. And they have a more favorable risk profile, meaning less risks, because we're not trying to target such a big pressure lowering response that we used to do with the bigger, more dangerous surgeries, perhaps.
Got it. Speaking of surgery, when the glaucoma developed into which kind of level, it has to be down with surgery. Otherwise, there is a high risk to be blind or vision loss.
Well, we usually say that patients who have very severe disease, and severe is going to be defined by different methodologies, but yes. Patients with very severe disease who are not appropriately controlled on glaucoma medications would benefit from surgical procedures, because if their pressures are not well controlled and they're still having worsening of their vision loss, then certainly we should intervene surgically. That being said, even for patients who have mild or moderate glaucoma, who either don't tolerate medicines or are forgetful of using medications, early surgical intervention can still be a good option for these patients as well.
So with an early diagnosis, glaucoma treatment can be more successful or less burdensome?
Correct, yes.
All right. I apologize that we're running out of time today. How about we leave the rest of the maze to next time?
That sounds good. Thank you.
Thank you. It's great to have you with us today. We will see you next time.
Thank you
观众朋友们，今天因为时间的关系呢，我们将把更多有关青光眼的谣言留在下一期，请潘医生继续为大家一一粉碎。那今天非常感谢您的收看，我们下期再见，祝您晚安。
您正在收看的是凤凰卫视。